Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our Conversations Art and Cinema series. We have the privilege and honor to have Charles Currier here with us, a producer, actor, and stunt coordinator. He has an extensive background in coordinating sword and stunt sequences and staging large medieval conflicts for live spectaculars in China and BBC television Lithuania. As an actor, Charles performed modern swordplay sequences in the film Secondhand Lions and had a guest role on the popular television series The West Wing. Charles coordinated military stunts for the History Channel series Warriors. He also choreographed fight scenes for the film Resident Evil Extinction, composed complex military formations for the film Alexander, and worked as the military technical advisor on HBO's miniseries Pacific. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Charles Currier with us. Welcome, Charles. So good to see you.
Evening. Absolutely.
Oh, and I love the suit of armor behind you. That's fantastic.
The random stuff in my office, but yeah. So I thought I would try to compose something interesting to look at. It happens to be there. That's most of a gothic suit of armor. Figure about 1400 back there.
Beautiful.
How we doing?
Doing great. We actually, we've been talking about creativity, inspiration. We just talked a bit with Mary Stankovich, who's a meditation teacher, about sort of centering yourself, how to deal with nervousness and anxiety. And now we want to know how to deal with all pent-up aggression and also how to sort of get those action sequences done, planned, and visualized. And for me, I think the sort of first question I have for you is sort of when we're drafting our scripts, right? And we're writing these action scenes down, what are you really looking for as a stunt coordinator in that language? And, you know, do we need to be very specific about things? And is there a certain script that, like, when you're reading through, you're sort of like, oh, you know, this is not really getting it? Like, what are the key things we need to sort of look for as we're doing our action description?
I like the question. You know, and honestly, every construct, right? Every project, web series, stage play, a film production, franchise, whatever, you know, opera, you know, everyone that includes some violence, you know, you're going to have that overlap between the writer, producer, director, and it takes a lot of courage for them, frankly, to yield some control's too hard a word, but yield some decision-making power to a stunt coordinator or a fight choreographer, a military tech advisor. It's a difficult thing, and every single time out of the gate, it's a new building of relationships. So how do you use it well? Well, first off, pay attention to those around you, right? Who are your resources when you're starting out as a filmmaker? You know, your family, your friends, somebody you might have met through PK or ultimately me or somebody else. And you go, oh, hey, you know what? My uncle Jerry is a Korean War veteran. So you know what? I should buy him a coffee and like open him up and sound him out on a bunch of shit. Or you know, I know my friend Suzanne did doubling on a movie in Chicago. So, and she doubled, you know, a famous person and maybe did a couple of falls or something like this. So let me engage them. But you can always reach, I always encourage you as you're writing to reach out to experts that you may already have in your field, right? And if you don't have a bunch of specific, okay, I don't know anyone who's expert in rapier and dagger combat in Verona, Italy in 1516. Okay, maybe not, right? So, but you can still talk to maybe, you could reach out to me through BK if you need that specific thing. But you know, just cast about for people that might be expert in this. So that being said, remembering what we're doing on film or on stage, that there is no real violence on a production. There can't be, right? You can't do it. You can't have actual violence, damage to other human beings. So the fight scene that you want to write, the how you slay Dracula, the scene where name a warrior, you know, Rasputin gets killed, whatever that scene that you're thinking of, it's not actually happening. What we're doing is a series of camera tricks, sleight of hand illusions, magic stuff, that put on screen or on stage a series of events which in the audience member's head becomes the violent act, right? So, and that's, I have to remember that, right? I get into things where it's so close to real that, you know, while you're staging something, that you got to remember, we are pretending over here, folks. No one's dying in this. We need to get all of these events to happen through the frame of that camera and in the audience's mind without anybody getting so much as a stubbed toe, you know? And that's kind of a pretty big set of tricks. It is doable. It is doable, I believe, on any scale, right? PK and I were shooting the breeze in the faculty lounge of an institution. He started to sound me out about my stage combat instruction. I started to talk about things I have done, but more than that, the things that I have done that make me want to do other projects that, like, you know, I've done a lot of zombies, but I haven't quite gone to this place yet, or I haven't quite told this story physically yet. And so the next thing I know, PK comes back to me going, okay, I'm halfway through a script. I wrote you into it. How do we do all this shit? You know? Okay, you want to show this just for a point of reference?
Holy shit.
God. You, Brad, put these on. Move over!
What the hell is going on?
Who are you?
Dara!
Why are you here, Dara?
I was invited!
Okay. Hold on to what you got. We got a situation. There's a few more of these things than we thought, so we're gonna have to get this shot as quickly as possible.
Get the shot?
Yeah, the scene, the shot that you're in. You're the host, right?
Okay. That scene still makes me chuckle. So, you know, there are some potential dangers. A car, of even that compact car, is 4,000 pounds. You know what I mean? I have prop firearms, but they do make an explosion inside that chamber. They have to be controlled. They have to be aimed. There's all kinds of circumstances that could get dicey. But, you know, the car isn't moving above 10 miles an hour, right? That's one thing we eliminated. We are in the middle of nowhere. There is no other traffic that's going to show up without us having at least a 3-mile advance warning that we can tie down the road. So nothing that happened with the car, you know, now, PK was clever about adding smoke and the squealing tires and all of that. None of that happened in actuality, right? That's an additive. I moved the car somewhat abruptly. That helps. But all of those little things are done with an understanding that if I'm firing the prop gun theoretically at the zombie actors. Actually, I'm aiming off. I'm not aiming directly at them. I'm aiming off to the side, but we arrange the camera where you can't tell. It's called an aim off, right? we'll talk more about that. I know there's been recent history, recent horrific history that I talked about the last time I was visiting you folks. That I don't want to completely hijack our conversation, but clearly through recent traumatic history, we, you know, attention to detail about these small things, even as you're performing, even as you're directing, even as you're operating a vehicle or a camera or anything, the attention to detail is absolutely key to making this happen. So in that set of shots, which we got, it was less than an hour that we got all of it. All right. Cause we were moving on. PK, you know, he's next to him. Clint Eastwood is, you know, they're fast. They don't linger on stuff. We got to get the next sequence. So, but we got the zombies getting hit. I'm aiming off. I knew all those zombies. They were former students of mine. I could tell them how to do safe falls. And so we didn't have to take a lot of time choreographing them going to the ground. I could say, hey, do this fall and do this reaction. And that saved us time on set. I know to aim off. I made sure everybody knew that the firearm was not capable of sending any kind of projectile downrange. I didn't know that car very well, but I knew the two actors that were in it. So we were able to do that sequence fairly fast. But, you know, the thing is, we worked out the zombies, we worked out the falls, we worked out the reactions, we worked out the gun use, we worked out the ear protection. I even wrote that into the scene. I don't think we wrote that in, but I was like, the moment I'm using actual blanks in that space, I had ear protection on, and I made ear protection part of the gag. Hey, are you Brad? Put these on, right? So in a way, you're right. Like you'll hear me say this more often than a lot of times. If you can't fix it, feature it. Right? PK wanted the blanks. I wanted us to be safe. Ear damage happens. So I just made that part of it. Now I think it's one of my favorite moments, is that I, you know, my character has thought so far ahead that he's providing ear protection for the two performers in the car. I think that's funny. Anyway, we did that whole sequence and it was pretty quick and efficient to shoot. And zero injury. The thing is that now that I look at it, something like I'm getting into a compact car pretty quickly, and it was Brad who displaced onto Hannah in that shot. You know, now that's a small thing. And when you think cars, gun, blanks, all this other stuff, you wouldn't say, hey, someone could get injured jumping onto somebody else's lap across a parking brake. You know what I mean? Like, you wouldn't, in all the things in that scene, you wouldn't anticipate, but someone could get a scratched cornea unintentionally scraping someone getting over onto the seat on top of them. So even then, you need to be vigilant, you need to plan stuff out, but then you also got to look, hey, what is happening? For us to make the shot, what is actually happening, and have we looked at all the possible ways this could be a problem? Will the skirt get caught on the coffee cup holder as they're transitioning to the other seat, and will that create some kind of liability? So we were very thorough on that low budget zombie movie that we made. And yet there were probably a couple of things that, you know, where we you can't possibly think of everything, but you have to at least try, and you have to put a culture in your production of trying to look at all the possibilities and trying to equip the actors and the on-set personnel with everything they need to do to feel confident, safe, and effective at doing their job. So, and that's a lot. I know it sounds like a very uphill battle, but you can do it. He's putting up a picture of Alexander, and God bless it. I love this experience. easy? No. But I'll prep it.
Do you want me to play something first before you...
You're starting the Battle of Galgamela here. I don't know how much time we have. I think this thing ended
up... I'll just do a 20 seconds and then you can sort of talk about it. Is that... Mm-hmm. Because I think that this is a nice sort of thing to go from something that's a low budget to sort of scaling it super big and sort of, you know, how much does the, you know, how does that end up happening? And how much Absolutely. Do stunt coordinators actually end up really, they're directing those sequences. They're not actually directed by the directors. And I want everyone to be aware of that stunt coordinators are actually directors of action scenes, really.
Many of them transition into second unit directors and enter the DGA that way. There usually is a transition as a stunt coordinator gets up there in age that they tend to transition to DG to second unit directors. But a lot of them go back and forth. Anyway, let's see what we got here. We had Moroccans, we had Berbers, Arabs, and Farsi speakers. We had Italian, Spanish, British, and all of the like the Kiwis and everybody else. So by the time we got done just putting everybody on the set with their horses and their camels and everything else, it's you got 8 languages. So it was loopy trying to make all of that work out. The idea was, though, we're recreating something that happened 2,300 years ago. And very specific. And it's, and I'm, there are other movies about this time period, which I don't think even come close. Like, to me, everybody loves 300. I can't stand it. It is absolutely nonsensical to me. But what we did was try and make the Alexander truly be seen as this brilliant military commander. So we staged the Battle of Galgamela as accurately as we could. We used 1,200 people at a time and were wheeling them through the desert, the Western Sahara, in correct formations. But that means that your set is as far as your eye can see. It is horizon to horizon. That your set is miles across, right? And if you've got Colin Farrell there, you know, doing his speech, you know, where do you put his headset to cue him? You know what I mean? Like it's got a helmet on, so you have to be creative. You can't really do command and control with any modern tech because it'll show up on the body, right? Like, oh, he's got a mic pack on and he's supposed to be, you know, 315 BC. So there's a couple of different weird challenges here, but ultimately our solution was, if we train Colin correctly and all the lead actors participated in the boot camp, some of them didn't like it. I'm spacing on the actor's name. But good actor, but he did not want to be in the desert. He did not want to be bit by the bugs for 3 weeks waiting to start the cameras rolling. But to us, that the thought was, if we train the actors to a point where they don't know how to do it wrong, it's solved, right? But I'll just tell you, on that set, if you don't like the fact that you're working with all those languages, I wasn't fluent in Berber or Persian, but at one point I was training the Greeks and all the English-based guys, and then they go, okay, Currier, you got the gamma units looking pretty good. We like where your troops are. You're now shifting to the other side. You got to train the Persians. And so then I got all the languages on me and I'm going like, oh, how do I reach these guys? And how do I form them up in position to do these very specific maneuvers? And then I thought, oh, now I have to make archers, you know? And like, so I remembered some of my French and that sort of worked, right? I used bullshit French and Latin, but the Berbers understood that, and some of the Farsi speakers understood that. And so I'd go, you know, Premier Linea, Tout Le Monde, you know, and what they figured out that the funny bald guy was saying was, hey, that means I aim my bow high into the sky to cover all the world, toot them on. So I all I'm saying is, I don't know if that was the best solution or not, but what I managed to do was reach people with enough of their language, with enough of their terminology. I'd learn a couple of words in Berber or in Farsi or whatever, but I would learn enough so I could call commands and they could react instantly. And then it started to look pretty good. Now, back to how do I make movies with this? I don't know that you can plan all that. I know that when you're doing, if you're doing Alexander, the life, you know, you're doing the life and times of Napoleon, right? So you're going to have 50,000 people on set. Good luck with that. But to do that, you're going to be thinking in terms of long preparation. You're going to be having a military tech advisor. I'd reach out to one prior to you finishing the writing. And because it'll help you get the details right. And then you're going to be thinking in terms of a sizable pre-production, including 2 to 3 weeks of a boot camp. That's my ideal world. That's expensive, so you have to convince people to do it. Now, Oliver Stone wanted it to be right. He had worked with my boss Dale multiple times since Platoon, which is what, 1986 or something, and they both won Oscars for that. So the idea of establishing a boot camp for the actors and having it be literally correct on the most base level is that's kind of a special thing. And Hollywood has seen that work repeatedly, and yet they don't always follow that guideline. A lot of people still think they can throw up we'll have a SWAT team on film, or we're going to have a set of World War II Marines on film, or we're going to have future Amazon Valkyries coming down from the sky in a huge wave, and we don't need to rehearse that. We'll do it on the day. When you have that sort of element in a movie, you're going to be thinking, for that to be right, we're going to have this preparation time and this, you know, this sort of detail and budget to work it. And it's not easy to always get that in. I think I want to revert, but anybody got any questions on anything I said? That was a pretty broad set of strokes.
I love your stories and I think you're fantastic and I love you. So just know that. Well, and I think the other thing is for you is that you are a person with such a wealth of information that there are a couple things to point out. It's sort of like thing that I'm hearing from Charles, as far as our script writing goes, it's sort of like anytime we have any type of physical action, right? It's a good idea to contact somebody that is some type of fight coordinator or that knows something about stage combat, because you can have them look at what you're doing and even start talking about how to plan this and even start talking about what that means. But also in knowing, and this is the second part of what I think Charles is really drilling home to us, this all takes a lot of time, effort, and preparation. And you're not going to do it automatically. So for everybody that's getting ready to do your short films, you know, the amount of pre-production you do, the amount of storyboards, the amount of visualization, the amount of literally rehearsing. So don't think that we don't rehearse these things and plan them out, especially when there's any kind of movement or action involved. It's really all about that. Absolutely. Choreography. And I'll let Charles sort of take it over from here. And then open it up to questions after that.
I'm proud of the moments that have worked well. But the last time there was a writer's strike was 2007. And I'm working with Dale Dye. We're doing the HBO series Pacific. sequel to The Band of Brothers, which was so successful. And so we're in Australia, and the writer's strike starts mid-production. And like, we're on episode 5 or 6 out of 10. And I'm okay. So of the military cadre working for Dale as advisors, I'm the guy with the medical knowledge. I was a Navy corpsman in reality in the US Navy, providing medical first responder stuff to Marines and things like that. So when we got this movie about World War II, or this project about World War II Marines, like, hey, Charles, you cover the medical shit, you know, which is how everybody refers to it. And I'm like, this is important stuff, right? But so here's Peleliu. Yeah, this is the sequence we're working on. Now, if you look, you're gonna see James Badge Dale, you're gonna see John Seda, you're gonna see Remy Malek got his start here. You're going to see John Bernthal, actors that were just about to break out in 2007, 2008. And there's at least 6 guys in here that are now like in half the stuff you're watching. There's Freddie Joe. That's the kid from Jurassic Park. Later was with Remy Malek in Bohemian Rhapsody. Anyway, but look at all this. We got a real tank. We got this crazy set. We got all these Marines. All those weapons can fire. We're all over the map here. And this, again, is pretending. Now, that set was cast concrete. It was probably 50 feet tall with ravines. They built... I don't know. I'm going to say it was about 400 feet across in every direction. And they built this whole set of crevices with wire and then sprayed concrete on it. So everything you touched was hard, sharp, and would scrape the shit out of you. On that is a bunch of water. There's Remy Malek right there operating his mortar. We had to boot camp him, you know. Remy Malek is very much a what you see is what you get actor, but he committed to this boot camp, and within 3 weeks we had him operating a mortar with the efficiency of a World War II Marine. I had James Badge Dale, John Seda, my star actors. I trained them in a unit where they were just another trooper, and I got them as capable on the M1917 water-cooled machine gun and the M1919 air-cooled machine gun. They could do that faster than the preparations of a World War II Marine, like whatever the time phrase was that you would expect. Okay, if you're going to be a Marine in a machine gun section in World War II, this is the time you're expected to put this weapon into action. And those actors could beat it. And yeah, they scraped their elbow and they, you know, whatever, they got sprayed in the eye with some oil or whatever else, but we trained them to a point where they were, again, it's not acting anymore. They are behaving correctly. And Marines can watch it and go, that's right. Now, there's an actor named John Seda. I think he's doing a TV series called Chicago Fire now. He's been in some stuff. Really super nice guy. I'll tell you this one kind of story, just to kind of give you a little bit of perspective that even on, this is the most expensive thing HBO has ever done. It's got the highest powered people involved, Spielberg and Hanks on production, Tony Toe, who now is vice president at Disney. These are powerful mega moguls, right? But there was an actor who had the best part. The best part in the series to me was John Bassalo, a famous Marine who lived and won, was awarded the Medal of Honor and was killed at Iwo Jima leading his troops. A pretty phenomenal human being for real. So there's an actor hired to play this guy. We get on an airplane in LA 17 hours to Cairns, Australia. Then you got a 3-hour puke your guts up ride through the mountains to get to where we were doing the boot camp. But by the time the actor who had, again, in my mind, the best breakout role you could have, Manila John Bassalone, Marine, by the time he gets to Australia on the 17-hour plane ride, he had so pissed off a couple of key people that already phone calls are going back to Tom Hanks in L.A. about this guy is unfit for this job. So by the time we get to the first day of boot camp, about 36 hours later, and we're now in triple canopy rainforest, we built these camps, we've got Japanese actors training, we've got American, Kiwi, and Canadian actors training in this place. Tom Hanks shows up, walks up to the guy who had, in some fashion, in the previous day, made himself unpleasant. And Hanks says, "You're not doing this. Head home." Turns to John Seda, who had a minor character, and says, "You up for this? Role of a lifetime." And John said, sure, you know, and he rose to the occasion immensely. I ended up meeting Tom Hanks. Like, I knew he was a producer, but I didn't really have a lot of interaction. I think we traded a couple of emails about content in the scripts that I was reading. But, you know, he shook my hands and he looked at all the other tech advisors like, "I'm so glad you guys are here. You guys are going to make it real." And he said, and then he leans in and he says, "If it doesn't look like documentary footage shot in HD, I'm sending you home." And he threatened me in the nicest possible way. But now here's my takeaway. I loved it because to hear the commitment from a producer, director, actor in his own right, obviously, the commitment that he wanted it as right as it could possibly be. He was enabling me to go the extra mile, look for the detail, get it right. And that was empowering. That fueled me for 10 months of working in extremely harsh conditions to make the scenes right. Now, back to what I originally started talking about. So one actor, just because he was not pleasant, you know, lost the role of a lifetime, and another actor jumped in and succeeded with it. But back to the idea of, I was on set, we're now halfway through the shooting schedule, the writer's strike starts, which means that Stephen Ambrose, who was like this Pulitzer Prize winning writer of the book, who has written a couple of the screenplays, and then but the episode writer's there, but he can't speak, Bruce can't speak, even though he's got Emmys under his belt, because he's technically on strike. And then you have my boss, Dale Dye, and you have the director, Carl Franklin, who came over from the Wire series. Great guy, not necessarily as wound up about the military correctness as I was, but Carl Franklin was a great guy. But you have all these guys on set, and the script said, I remember it very clearly, I was the medical guy, right? So they were like, "Okay, we have this major character, Hoosier, getting hit in the leg." And the script, you know, is like, Hoosier takes a round and goes down into the shell crater. And then in capital letters is written, "The wound is not arterial." Okay, what do you do with that? Most people don't care, but I'm the medic, so I've got to care about this, right? So if a wound is arterial, that means to me, that means if it's in a blood supply thing, that means the heart is closer to the wound, which means that you're going to see spurting from an arterial wound, where if it were a wound in a vein, which is the return flow to your heart, that would be a slower flood. So arterial spurts, and venal drains, I guess is the way I'll say it. Everybody with me so far? Having fun? Look at what you're learning. All right. So the script is very specific. It's based on a true event that the wound is not arterial, but the special effects guy apparently didn't read that script because he rigged this awesome bladder thing that sploot, 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 like it was like a jet of blood spraying around it. And Carl Franklin was like, dude, I want this to look like The Shining, you know, like waves of blood coming through, you know, and I'm going like, well, I understand the art of the wave of blood, but, you know, a full-size person has about 5 quarts of blood. So if you show 5 gallons, that's kind of a misnomer, right? And again, in reality, the character of Hoosier lives. That actual guy survived that injury, made it home, and lived another 30 years after World War II. So, all right, that's a lot of weird pressure. The writer can't say anything, and yet we have his last script that gives us this very specific thing, but the special effects guy has rigged something that doesn't tell what's in the script, and they're asking me to solve it. And at this point, we're filling this shell crater with blood, gallons of blood from the bottom. And ultimately what that was to me was, it's a lie. It's kind of like a jump scare in a Halloween movie, because it's a cheat to show gallons of blood and you go, that guy's dying, and then bring him back next episode. Oh, he survived, no problem. You know, I know that that may not be something that anybody but me cares about, but I was very uncomfortable on that set because I wanted to please Carl. I had to please my boss, Dale Dye, who was pissed off beyond measure. The writers were freaking out, but they couldn't say anything about it. And ultimately, what I tried to do was say, hey, if I can recommend camera angle, I tried to de-emphasize, you know, waves and gallons of blood and make, you know, try to move on the actor playing the medic, trying to do the interventions, what that would look like. We focused on those details, and I think we ended up coming up with a fairly truthful scene. But nobody went home happy. And that's another thing that struck me is like, we're all here to do good work, right? We're all in our departments, you know, and our specialties, and we're all here to get it right, right? And yet, even in those situations, the bigger the production gets, somehow the less capable, the less easy and direct it is to have the communication before the shooting, before the photography, to get these details right. A lot of people don't care. A lot of movies get made without this kind of attention to detail. I'll tell you this, I knew on this movie we were going to have actual veterans talking to us and meeting us when we finished it. You know, I remember we went to the premiere at Man's Chinese Theater in Hollywood. Big event. You know, all the stars are there, all the producers are there. But we also brought World War II veterans. These are 90-year-old dudes, men and women, in their uniforms. They're not, you know, I'm 6'2" and like 220 pounds. But there was a dude who knew, like, there was a guy, a World War II veteran who was about 5'6" and about 104 pounds in his dress blue uniform. But I thought, there is a 90-year-old man who could kick my ass if I made a mistake on this, because I'm responsible for telling the story of his friends that he knew that fought, some that lived, some that died. And he's looking at me, he's trusting me to get the truth on that screen. And again, you can choose to not like that and not make films like that. I choose to love it. You know, I think I'm going to chime in on what PK was discussing right as I signed in. The year of 2006, 2007, and 2008, that span, the year as I was leaving for Australia, I did the Resident Evil 3 zombie movie, came back to LA briefly, did an opera at LA Opera with major international opera stars, where I did a Carmen. I had to do a saber fight and a knife fight. And then I left on the plane to come to go to Australia to train. So I had a fantasy science fiction, who cares about reality, you know, franchise about zombies. Then I did an opera, and then I did this. How real can it be? 10 episode series for HBO. I loved that year, right? All of these things are requiring different skill sets and different approaches, but the breadth of storytelling there, it was a thrill to me. And I still love a year where the projects come from all over the place. I'm doing a documentary here. I'm doing a video game over there. I'm doing zombie killing. Vegas, baby, Vegas, except we were shooting it in Algodones, Mexico. All right, Odin Fair, great actor. He was actually in the military in the Israeli Defense Force, so he was pretty easy to train. That's Greg. Hey, Greg, you're gonna die. Okay. All right, that's Tim. Well, that's Leighton. All right, I'm just looking at all my guys playing the Uber zombies. Yeah, this is gritty reality at its best, for sure. Now, okay, there are the Kukri knives. Uh-oh, ass is gonna be kicked. Okay, we got the double decapitino. Lots of wire work. But a lot of these best reactions to me are, like, I hired actor stunties that could do the simple stuff on their own. And it saved us time. Like, when we don't have to rig someone with a wire and they can sell a reaction that's truthful, it really saves time. Of course, I got another story about this sequence. Okay, get that zombie. All right. I taught her to do that. Okay. All right.
I'm going to go ahead and open it up to questions, because I'm sure there's so much you can talk about. You can talk about acting. You can talk about how do they hire stunt coordinators, so much stuff. Let's hear from the students. Folks, okay. Do you have questions for Charles? Please ask away. Because if he starts going, it's going to be, you know, another story, and you got to get your questions in, you know?
This is a 10 episode miniseries, right?
Yeah,
yeah,
exactly.
I just wanted to ask, and you kind of touched on this earlier, but like, how closely do you have to interact with like writers, actors, directors, stunt people? You said something about special effects. Like, are you kind of, is it all, you guys all working together, or are they all coming to you with their problems and you have to be like, this is how it goes?
You know, that's a very intuitive question. I wish there were more consistency. What I said back in the beginning, every production is a new lashup, right? It's like a new construct. So now that I have been through the mill a couple of times, I instantly try to get connected to all the departments. Yes. In an ideal world, we would all be super cooperative, you know? I have been yelled at, but I remember at one point for Resident Evil, I showed up with the weapons. I had them built by an armorer. I had trained Mila with these. We had rehearsal props that looked great. We had a couple of things, but then all of a sudden I'm getting yelled at by a stranger in the middle of a hotel in Mexicali because he's claiming that I didn't show up in time to let him take my weapons, and then he was going to make like plastic props off of them or something. And I'm like, we've never exchanged we never even exchanged an email. You can't be mad at me for, you know, like, there's no way. I said, I'm willing to help you now. And so we had this shouting match in the middle of a large atrium in a hotel. And I said, I am not the source of your problem. I'm willing to be part of your solution. If you're willing to work with me, let's figure it out. So ultimately, that was an awkward encounter. But because, all right, truthfully, I'm a hothead. I am a heart on my sleeve, emotional SOB. When I'm the coolest headed person in the room, I start to worry. But in this particular case, I thought, this is a big space. There's a lot of personalities here. I need to keep my cool. And I tried to respond with healthy, restrained responses. I just said, look, you're not in the right headspace. I'm here to support. You know, you want to reach out to me once you're past this moment, I'm all ears. So I let it go at that. But I'll say, because I didn't get ballistic, the one time I didn't get ballistic, that guy from the next day on was my cheerleader. He's like, oh, Charles, yeah, no, that was just a crazy thing. We're fine. You know, hey, I love how you, like, all of a sudden there was nothing this guy wouldn't do for me or with me. And we solved those problems and it turned around. You know, again, as many times as I've had, I chose the right path, I've chosen the wrong path a couple of times, because it just surprises me that the different departments on some of the bigger stuff, they can get a little competitive and not so mutually supportive. That's a rare thing, but it does happen. And I would be remiss at prepping you for the industry. You know, you're going to make your small little feature initially, your first couple of projects will be scaled where you have a lot of your nerves are connected to everybody on the set. You've personally hired everybody on the set. Some of the bigger things, it's like whole departments show up that you as the director or the writer or the producer, you barely even interacted with. And now you're in the middle of Botswana trying to make something crazy happen. And it doesn't always work with perfect, interpersonal negotiation. Like strange things that you couldn't predict, but like back to Alexander, all that resource, that was the most expensive movie made at the time of 2002. But, you know, we are making a movie in 2002, or actually it was 2003. Why? Because we were starting the second Iraq war, right? So we're making a movie about a bunch of Europeans going to Persia and kicking a bunch of ass at the same time as George W. is gearing up our military to go into Iraq. And we ended up shooting this thing during Ramadan. And 900 of our 1,200 people are people, I mean, not everybody. Berber is different than Arabic, that is different than Persian. You know, there's a lot of variance in there, but there were a lot of people whose sensibilities were, we don't want to hear a lot of gung-ho stuff about, you know, European looking white boys coming to kick, you know, Middle Eastern butt. It, like, that's not a positive thing. And I was very aware of this. And it ultimately, I love everybody I train. Dale Dye told me, you got to love them to lead them. So I don't care where you come from, what corner of the world, what your belief system is. If you're my guys, you're my guys. You know what I mean? And I'm gonna show you that I will feed you before I'll feed myself. I will, you know, I will do anything to keep you healthy and feeling supported. That being said, during Ramadan, you know, these guys are starving themselves all day long. We are in the Western Sahara. We are working 12 hours in extreme heat, August, September, and these guys aren't taking a grape or a slug of water from 07 to 7 p.m. you know, I am not a pleasant human being. If you starve me for 7 hours, if I started at 7 a.m. and it's now 2 p.m. and everybody else is, all the Europeans are getting a lunch and I'm not pleasant. I'll straight, you know, I don't know how those guys ultimately, and we're talking 900 military folks from Moroccan infantry, you know, I would have been in a worse mood than they were. They were still, we had some fights on set because people got cranky and, you know, they got hangry. But we, you know, honestly, they put in hours that I would have been hard pressed to duplicate. And I want to honor that at the same time saying we were staging the big battles and sometimes we'd call cut and there's still fights going on because there's an actual 2003 fist fight happening in the middle of our 2300 years ago, you know, ancient battle. So like, and just like, hey, calm down guys, listen, it's not, we'll take care of you. Like just getting it. So I never imagined that we would be in something as, irony is one of the words I was going to use, but you again, everybody was smart. Everybody was planning schedules and oh, we're hiring these guys and this group's going to come in and we'll be shooting in early fall. Like, you know, these are not dumb people. The ADs, the producers, you know, all of us were actively trying to solve problems, but trying to anticipate how locals would feel with the current international political social conflict going on, the one that we're replicating during a religious observance period, you know, like that, once you get all those things coming into a space, you gotta be able to adapt. You gotta take that heart. You know, I know a lot of the guys I was leading didn't think like me, didn't speak like me, didn't believe like me, but it was like, let's connect on a human level. Let's treat each other with respect and love. And let's try to get this shot without anybody taking a ding. And we did. We accomplished, I think, remarkable things on that set and many others. But it you know, at some core level, you know, all of your planning is going to go to shit anyway. You can't not plan. But even with your planning, there's going to be stuff that's unexpected. And then it comes down to how are you really going to be engaging others on set with you know, a kindness and a generosity and a willingness to adapt and solve problems, because the problems are coming, you know. Hey, you give me 1200 guys that are trained in land navigation, you know, British special forces, and I go, okay, well, certain things I don't have to solve, these guys are good to go. We had a windstorm come up in the Sahara and you couldn't see your hand in front of your face. And, you know, I'm tying British Special Forces troops together so that they can go to the bathroom together and all come back, because you did, you know, you could be buried in the sand in 15 minutes. And you know, like just weird stuff like that, but it became, you know, all of a sudden, okay, if we're going to the potty, we're going to do it as a group and we're going to be literally lashed together because we won't be able to see where we're going. You know, things like that, that you just, I mean, hopefully you're going to be making movies there around Southern Illinois and you'll, you know, you'll understand the circumstances of your environment, but you will get surprised, and your willingness to adapt and the genuineness with which you engage all the people supporting your project is going to pay off. It'll make a difference. And those relationships, you know, it's no surprise that once a relationship works, you tend to keep pulling that person back. PK and I will pull each other into projects for the rest of our lives, right? Dale Dye, Vietnam veteran, former Marine, very right wing. Oliver Stone, former Army, Vietnam veteran, very left wing. these guys are as antipodal in belief system as you can get. But since Dale talked Oliver into hiring him for Platoon in 1986 or whatever that was, they've made like 9 movies together. And they argue and they bicker and they completely flip out on each other in certain contexts. But then the next day they're up at 06 and they're making brilliant shit happen and then laughing about it on the way home. That relationship, as bizarro as it could possibly be, you know, they find that they do their best work that way. Well, that was a long ass answer to your question. I hope I even covered what your original intent was.
But no, I love it because that's the brilliance of you, Charles, is that Prime asked a question that really you unpacked so well, and you gave so many dimensions to the possibility and so many gems of wisdom in it about what the Hollywood process is, how we can navigate it, how we can relate to one another, preparedness, safety, interacting, the unexpected. It's really all of it. And I can really hear it in your storytelling that when these stories come up, it's sort of like you're in it too. You're in those moments and you go back to them. So are there any other questions from folks?
Does anybody
want to ask about acting or horror films, anything? Dejanay?
I have the question. I'm Dejanay. I'm going into my third year at SIUC. One thing that really stood out to me that you said was basically staying true to the concept of the story. And I thought that was pretty awesome because I'm a creative writer and I'm starting script writing as well. So that really resonated with me. But the question I have for you is, do you have a good contact information that you want to share in the chat for us?
Oh, sure. And I mean, I PK can make it available to you. I'm more than willing to be a resource for you guys. And, you know, I was just talking to a colleague of mine. She's writing books in Italy. I just saw her a couple weeks ago, you know, and she's writing teenage pirate books, right? But she's like, okay, when you're on ship and you're trying to use a sword, do you have space to do this? Or is it more like, you know? And so she had a bunch of interesting questions about, yeah, a sailing ship, which has got ropes going in every direction, and you've got a sharp edge blade there, and you're trying to defend yourself, attack an opponent, and not destroy the ship's rigging in the process, you know? So it wasn't a particularly hyper serious book, but before she finished a concept, she was very clever to, you know, draw me out a little bit on what it's like to do ship fighting with edged weaponry. And I think it's a thrill for me to get the call, you know, like, oh, okay, let's try this, you know? I've advised on novels, web series, stage plays, you know, operas, musicals, films, episodics. So if I can be a resource, I know, it's been a minute since I worked in the like St. Louis to Chicago corridor. Actually, PK and I are hoping to change that. You know, like we'll look at dreaming up a project in the not too distant future. But I still know some folks. Like, if you decide that you're going to do something in Michigan, I still might have a name to give you. Hopefully, they're still there working. But you know, you can do a lot with planning and clever actors. And some of the schools, like if you get, let's say you're making a horror movie, you're going to shoot it in Illinois, and but you get a chance to put up a casting notice at like Champaign, Urbana, whatever that college university is up there, right? So there are actors there that are getting trained in stage combat, sword fighting, hand to hand, basic tumbling. They're getting trained by this brilliant guy named Robin McFarquhar. And, you know, if you go, okay, I got I got like a sword fight between the vampire and the fencing coach character, and the fencing coach guy is going to die horribly, you know. But you could say, let me put in my casting to try and draw actors out that have the blade experience. Maybe, you know, maybe you start to see, okay, I actually, the actor I hired to play Dracula has got, you know, she's got 17 years of experience or whatever it is. So maybe I'll actually see if she wants to be the fight coordinator and work with me on that. You know, you can find people even in your region that have some skill sets. But I'm more than willing to be a resource, and PK, you can give them what, you know, email and phone if you want to, and make that available to them. But we absolutely want you to, you know, reach out to people who've done these kinds of things before. You're going to feel, in an ideal world, you're going to feel enabled to write something that's truthful to your vision and also, you know, is shootable, and it will be safe as you shoot it. And it's, I love all genres. But when you're making a detailed historical recreation, you've got to put the parts in place that make that honest and safe. When you're doing space fantasy, you know, crazy stuff, but you still have swords being used, you still have jumping around being used, you still have laser pistols being used, you still got to find a way to make that look good, but be safe. And all those things are infinitely doable, but reaching out to resources like myself and like others is the first step to getting it right and keeping it, staying healthy as you're doing. Anything else?
Thank you.
Absolutely. There you go. Yeah. So we're, you know, working out here, doing like a bunch of students. Well, excuse me. They're now professional filmmakers, but they were all young relative to me. But I just did Armory for a feature film funded out of Korea, I think. But we just did a funny dystopian film that they needed a bunch of weapons for. And it came off great. Again, these were not filmmakers that were, they were all from the USC film program, and they all graduated in the last 10 years. But we were able to do 3 weeks of shooting, had a bunch of firearms on set, got some fight scenes and some knifings done, but all of that was safe, touch wood. And even though they weren't necessarily the most experienced with violent action, they brought me and another stunt coordinator out early enough in the process that we were able to make it coherent, safe, and organized before the first shot was in the can. And that's really, you know, I point that up because, again, you don't have to be Oliver Stone, right? You don't have to have like a 40-year career to still have attention to detail and get it right and live to tell the tale.
Thank you so much, Charles. I know you've gone over time and you've really shared so much with us. Let's hear it for Charles and thank him for being with us. And hopefully you can come here in person and maybe we'll be shooting in this coming year. And I know for those of you that don't know, and I did not have this in the bio that was read, you know, Charles was in the Navy and he also runs Los Angeles Fight Academy. So for those of you that are visiting Los Angeles and want to practice doing stunts or get involved in that work, this is also a reason to contact Charles. And what we're hoping at SIU is to develop a course next summer where we go and shoot a movie in Los Angeles. And one of the things we'll be doing is working with Los Angeles Fight Academy in shooting some action sequences. So please be aware of that. And And if you're interested in learning stunts and how to do that in films, Charles is a great instructor, learning how to shoot guns safely, sword fighting, grappling, combat, all of this. Yeah.
I look forward to it. I really want to come play in the Midwest with you guys. And if you do get to come, like PK says, if you do get to come out here for a project that we create or one of your own, don't hesitate to look me up. It'll be fun to get together and get your project the next couple of steps down the road.
Thank you so much, Charles. It's been a pleasure. See you soon. Thank you. Thank you, Charles.
Thank you.
Bye, guys.
Thank you.